Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. As you know, since 1991, which is, by the way, the date of the first Iraq War, there has been a digital revolution in this country. All our lives have been changed by it. The internet, for example. The question tonight is, has there been a digital age in the military, too? And if there has been one, what impact will it have on our military capability as we think about Iraq? Joining us tonight to discuss this question is Colonel Walter Givhan, United States Air Force, and he is a military fellow at the Council of Foreign Relations. Thank you very much for joining us.
My pleasure to be here.
Well, let's go right to the heart. Has there been a digital revolution in the military?
Indeed, there has. It's been incredible to watch. The kind of capability that we are all familiar with through our own personal computers and the internet now is very much part of what we're doing in the military. Whether you're in the Army, the Air Force, or the Navy, for example, these kind of things, networks, digital networks linking things together are becoming increasingly the norm, and they're giving us an incredible capability.
Well, what would the digital networks link?
Well, for example, the Army did Force 21, which is the 4th Infantry Division. They were their first digital division, and they started in the mid-90s actually exercising capabilities that they're now bringing on a lot more mature form of a wireless digital network that links all the troops and their vehicles on the battlefield and uses global positioning satellites to tell them where they are, to tell them where the other person is, so that any person can see that. And
what do you mean see?
See the positions of all his friendly troops on a computer screen.
On a computer screen?
Yes. And designate enemy and allow them to appear so that everyone is sharing that information.
So this means that in every tank, there's a computer screen?
Yes.
How many?
They're having these. Well, there's one central screen that they're using for the picture,
is
as I understand
it.
And I don't want to, I'm obviously Air Force, but I can't speak to too much of the Army capability, except say that the idea here, again, is to have this common picture everyone can look at where everyone's information is, and that you can act on that information. Let me compare it just to give you how far they've come. Because I've worked a lot with the Army as an air liaison officer to them, so I've seen them. In my days, in the late 80s, early 90s, working with the Army, when you went into the operations center, that was where the, say, the brigade or the division commander might be doing things, there was a big map on the tent.
With pins in it.
With pens, or what they usually, they cover with plastic, and they'd write, and they'd show the position of the units, and then a radio call would come in saying, "We're here now," and you'd get that, or "We think we see the enemy here," and somebody would take grease pencil and write it up there. It's all on a screen now, and it's all available. It's available not just to that commander. It's available to the troops out there who can now act on that information, and the idea, too, it enables independent action as well. Because when a person can see this, he can take the initiative to act because he has the same information that this person over here might have. Whereas before, he might have been essentially blind to a certain extent or just able to see what was in front of him.
Well, so I started to ask you a few seconds ago about people actually in the tank working on a computer. This is pejorative, but it's hard for me to imagine nerds inside of a tank, but the question is this: does everyone in the Air Force take advanced computer training? I mean, Air Force in the military services.
I think what you find these days is that it's the computer and the digital sort of things that we do demand that a certain amount of technical training, obviously, and we do a lot of that training ourselves. It's not that you have to be a computer science major to come into the military, but it's one of the reasons that it's very important, especially in the Air Force, which I'm most familiar, because we put so much money into training these people and giving them this advanced training in computers and how to do these things.
In training in computers.
That we need to hold on to these people.
Oh, that's a different question.
I mean, because we put this investment, and so we are more of what we call a retention force. It's also one of the reasons that you have a hard time just having people come and go, because you want to retain that sort of expertise. But to kind of get into the different services, and because this is affecting all of us, the Navy has a similar wireless digital network that links its ships like a carrier battle group. And again, the idea is a system of systems, a network that can take information from any one of these systems, in the Army's case, a soldier, in the Navy's case, a ship, in the Air Force's case, all the different air platforms that it has, and bring this together, fuse this information, and make it available to others.
Well, would that mean that the commander-in-chief of an Iraq force such as POW was before, his job must have changed too, right?
Yeah, I think...
Excuse me, just to finish the question, because if you got networks and network, can he sit at a computer screen and have a whole bunch of information come in from different forces?
Yes, and that's what's happening now. You know, in Afghanistan, for example, a lot of this information they could view right in Tampa, Florida, at Central Command headquarters.
Can you just stop on that? Mm-hmm. Because I don't understand that. In Afghanistan, there was a laptop war, some people say, that the special forces people saw something, they put it in the computer, it went to the plane, and the plane bombed. That information also went to Tampa, Florida?
Well, they would be able to, for example, one of the uninhabited aerial vehicles that we use, drones, if you want to call them that, is Predator.
Yeah.
That Predator can look down with its cameras and sensors and see something on the ground. That information can be put all the way back as it was to Tampa, Florida, and they could look at it right there. So this sort of situation does put commanders in a completely different predicament than what they were before. And although we haven't seen a lot of this getting in the way, there is always this temptation, as you can imagine, if you're sitting there and you're seeing this, to act upon it. When a lot of times the best thing may be able to is, look, I know the people who are down there, you know, they've got eyes on and they can do it, and so I've given them general direction.
Oh my God.
I'm going to resist the temptation to say, I want to kill this and hit this.
They never had the temptation before.
They didn't have the power before. Now they can see it. Now they could, if they wanted to, try to run things at a more, you know, a micro level, as far back as the headquarters.
Compare for me, physically, your idea, because you may not know in fact, of Powell sitting there in 1991. He's running the whole Megillah, as they say in New York, that means everything. And whoever the Powell is this time, in the next future war that we may have, which might be Iraq, is the Powell of today really computer savvy, and he's sitting in a computer room? How do you think that works out?
Yeah, he's going to be in a command center, whether he's General Schwarzkopf in the Gulf War, whether he's the guy who's running the air operations, for example, because the air operations center now is one of these kinds of places where all of that information comes in. Say that Predator video, and there's a three-star general there who could potentially, if he wanted to, say, this is the way I want to do it, and actually direct an attack at the tactical level. Now, this is one of the things, obviously, that's new, so we'll continue to address it in our training as we bring commanders up about what's the proper way to handle this. And
they're going to have too much information.
Well, there's the potential, but if... And I still believe we have good commanders who are resisting the temptation to get down in the weeds. And
no,
do
but
the
I mean,
test.
Just how are they going to? If you had, let's suppose, predators are drones, dumb planes. Don't contradict me. dumb planes that have the ability to kill somebody on the ground with weaponry that's on the drone. But there's no one in the drone. The person who's running the drone is would it be back in Tampa? Would someone be running a drone in Tampa that's over Baghdad?
Theoretically possible, but we tend to put our operators
so up. So it'd probably be within 300 or 400 miles. Now, there aren't a lot of predators, actually. How many are there? There's only 20 or 30 of them.
It varies, right. We're continuing to produce them, so they're rolling off.
But anyway, just take the predator example. Suppose you got 30 predators out there.
Right.
That's 30 photos, okay, that are coming back to command headquarters in a war such as a war in Iraq, okay? Then you multiply that by every example we can think of. Every kind of computerized information is coming back. How is one person going to look at 20 photos? How is one person going to look at all the...
Well, he doesn't have to be one person. And I think that's what you're talking about really illustrates the power of the network. Part of the idea behind network-centric warfare, which is one of the concepts that you're hearing describing this, how the digital network works.
I haven't heard it before, so this is what we're talking about now.
That the network doesn't just empower that one person who's back there where everything comes in. The information is pushed out. And so that the people who are at the various parts of the network have more information
who pushes it out?
Well, the central air operations center, for example, is sort of your one of your big nodes where that information would be collected and then pushed back out. Now, for example, in the Predator's case, its video right now can go directly into an AC-130 gunship, which can take that video, look at it, and say, okay, that's the target, and then go engage that target. And so there doesn't have to be someone who's way back in the back who's making the decision or saying specifically to how to do that. That information can be acted upon in almost real time. And you have to understand that part of what we're trying to do here has to do with reducing this targeting, this sensor-to-shooter kill cycle to a matter of minutes. Whereas before, you might have a recce airplane or a reconnaissance airplane go out, take a picture, come back, we develop the picture. Days later, it gets to an aircrew, we plan a mission, we go out, and we hit that target. Well, is the target even still there? We may not even know till we get there. Now this can happen in almost real time, that information is taken digitally, put into another airplane from the Predator, and acted upon.
So we know in our personal lives, with our own experience in the digital world, such as email, that everything speeds up. Yes. Our lives speed up, everything goes faster. In the industrial world, that means people can do more in less time. That's so-called productivity. Some people think that productivity is what drove the stock market and probably will drive it again. So that's the same thing that's happening. Everything's new because everything's going so fast.
Yeah, the velocity of information is incredible and the way it's being pushed around. And the important thing, of course, though, is it's not just the speed of the information. It has to be the quality of the information and the availability of that information for people to act upon it who are in a position to do that. And that's what we're really about.
Well, when people think about the impact of technology and the digital age on military capability, one usually thinks of particular bombs, airplanes, so forth and so on. But what you're telling me is that the digital age has revolutionized almost the whole concept of war. Am I going too far?
No, I don't think you are. I think some people would actually make the argument that the current military technical revolution or revolution in military affairs, however you want to characterize it, is about information. And that the information revolution in the military is what we are on the leading edge of in the United States military, and it's one of the things that's really making us much more effective than we were in the Gulf War over 10 years ago.
Let's talk about another form of information warfare, if I may, cyber warfare. Now, in this country, we worry about being attacked by the terrorists in a form of cyber warfare. Do we have the capability of turning that around and attacking a country, say, like Iraq, in a similar fashion and completely neutralizing their ability to do anything?
It's a sensitive subject.
Can you talk about it?
I can talk in a very general terms about it.
All right.
That information operations writ large is a very important part of what we do and what we plan for. Now, there's three parts of that. There's electronic combat, which is the old, I'm going to jam your signals, or I'm gonna pick up your signals and interpret them, or and the countermeasures that go there. That we've been doing that for a long time.
Right.
There's influence operations, which dropping leaflets, for example, stories, whatever, the trying to influence, and then there are network operations.
Right.
Now there are. That's
when you're the last one I don't care. That's where you screw everyone up.
There are, and I can tell you that there are offensive and defensive capabilities in all of these areas to include the last one.
Well, some of the literature on this subject wonders about the ethics of it, and Bush apparently has even considered some guidelines. Do you think that it'll be a used weapon at some point in time in our...
I think the history of warfare shows that when something comes up, it eventually gets used. And you have to look at, as we already are, well, what does this mean? And how do we relate this to past experience and what's proper? And you know, the United States is always very concerned with the laws of war and the just war and
well, let's take a look at some of where the usual places you see technology, and that's in the bombs and the planes and all that sort of stuff. And first cousin to cyber warfare would be perhaps another subject you may not be able to talk about, but I'll ask you anyway. A microwave bomb. Can you tell us how it works?
I can't really talk about any details on that. I can tell you the theory.
Well, I mean, just what's out there.
Let's just talk about the theory.
Okay, the theory. Okay.
The theory is that, as I think science has shown, is that electromagnetic pulses can have a big effect on a system. You know, we can create problems just by jamming, but the idea of an electromagnetic pulse is that you can actually destroy a system or without, you know, just blowing it up.
In system,
you can,
you mean
you can
a,
fry it, well, like a computer system, for example, or a network.
Or electric,
by using
electric system.
By using electromagnetic pulses. Now, obviously, electromagnetic pulses can work both ways. So if you're going to use something like that, it would make sense that you would have to harden your own systems to protect them against something similar there.
So that's the problem.
That's the theory.
Well, in practice, in Kosovo, didn't we do something like that? We dropped a bomb that screwed up their electric capacity?
Well, what we've traditionally done, yes, but what we've traditionally done is different. It's not, use the carbon filaments to put over the wires to short circuit. The theory behind electromagnetic pulse as a weapon is different, to where it would actually take fry circuits and that sort of thing.
Okay, now the big story the last time around with Iraq was cruise missiles and smart bombs, okay? Now, I've read that smart bombs will be used 90% of the time rather than 10% of the time as they were last time. But putting smart bombs aside, what will be the big story in weaponry, do you think, if we were to have another war?
Well, I think if you look at our capabilities now, the big thing will be, as you already alluded to, the number of precision weapons.
Number of smart bombs.
Right.
We're going to have a lot
more. And the different kind that we use.
Right.
The other thing, and I think this is a chance to talk about sort of the several aspects of where we are. The stealth, for example.
Okay, what do you mean by that?
Now, in the first war, stealth means, literally what it is not being able to see an aircraft, essentially making aircraft not completely invisible, but very hard to detect by radar. Now, in the first Gulf War, you saw the F-117 Nighthawk, which was the stealth fighter. In this Gulf War, you'll see the next generation of stealth, which is the B-2, which was also so action during the Kosovo operation as well, but you would see it. So advanced stealth in the form of the B-2, advanced precision in terms of the joint direct attack munition, the GPS-guided bomb, in addition to the laser-guided bombs.
Let's stop for a moment. Let's just go back to stealth, and we get back to the GDM. Well, so what? I mean, why is the stealth so great? What does it do for us that
What it does is it reduces the amount, it says several things, but it reduces the amount of aircraft, for example, that you have to send in.
Reduces
in a traditional package, where with aircraft that were more visible to radar, you would have to send in lots of aircraft to support by jamming, aircraft to support by air superiority, by sweeping to make sure other fighters didn't come up. And this created what we call the package. Now you have a large package with lots of aircraft, lots of moving parts. A stealth means that the aircraft essentially is carrying its own air superiority with it, and it doesn't need those jamming aircraft, so it can go in alone without all of these other aircraft.
And you can't pick it up?
And it is very hard to detect.
You're about to give away a military secret. Okay, but what does it do besides get in there and no one can see it if that's what happens?
The other great the sensors and the capability on, say, a B-2, it's able to deliver 16 joint direct attack munitions, these precision GPS-guided bombs, and it can deliver them near simultaneously to 16 different targets.
I see. So now this is this JDAM system, which is a system that only costs $20,000.
Relatively inexpensive.
And it's a smart system, and you put it on a dumb bomb and use it up there, and you're as a pilot, which you are, and you hit the computer or whatever, and if you're in the B-1 stealth, it does what again? How many?
Well, in the B-2, you have 16 of these. Right. The B-52 can carry actually more than that now. And now you have B-52s and B-1s that are capable of carrying these planes too. They don't have the stealth capability that the B-2 has. So the B-2 can go in to a heavily defended area, which would have, such as Baghdad, for example, which would have large amount of air defense, surface-to-air missiles, things like that. And because it's hard to detect, you can't really target it, and it would be able to go in and target or hit numerous targets in those kind of heavily defended areas.
So you think the big story will be the B-2 and the...
Well, I think it's only part of the story. I think the stealth, the precision, the other thing that we've been talking about is going to be a player that... It'll be harder to get, you know, people will see it in little bits and pieces. That is the digital network, the information putting together and acted upon. And let's talk about that in terms of the UAVs. We did have...
Stop for a second. So you think that we talked earlier about the system. So you think that the system as such is going to be a big, we're going to read a lot about it.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a big deal. Huh?
I think that the way that we can act on this information, pull this information together and act on it, is going to be a story. And one of the ways that that'll come out, too, is when you hear about these predators, global hawks, these drones, if you will, these uninhabited UAVs, uninhabited aerial vehicles, that we have that are taking this information and either passing it directly to another airplane or bringing it back to an operations center to be pushed out to another airplane. We didn't have those kind of platforms in the first Gulf War. We had some very first generation sort of uninhabited aerial vehicles. They're going to be a lot more this time. So that'll be another big story, is how they
Let me just ask you about uninhabited air vehicles, UAVs, right?
Yes.
And we talked earlier about Predator. And Predator has gotten a lot of publicity, and people probably know what it is. I think it's fair to say they're not a lot of predators, though. There's only a couple dozen or something, isn't that right?
Yeah, I don't know what the exact number is.
Well, but are there other UAVs, what I'm trying to get at?
The Global Hawk, for example. Now, the Global Hawk is a higher altitude one. It's whereas the Predator is a lower altitude, has a propeller. The Global Hawk is a jet, goes up to higher altitude, and can see, as a result of that, a lot longer, covering a wider area, and has sensors that are obviously optimized for being able to do that.
So we've got lots of these UAVs?
And they're increasing in number every day.
That's these questions you never get.
But, you know, the thing about it is that they're not just part of, we've had the satellites for a while, but, you know, a satellite goes around, and unless it's in a particular orbit where it's just focusing on one spot, you may not have the satellite over the particular area every moment. When you have now a Global Hawk and a Predator, you can really focus on a particular area and have these eyes on continuously.
And
information being pulled back, and then you can act on that information
quickly. But when you're going back to you up in the pilot's part of the plane, cockpit they call it, don't they? And you're dropping a super smart bomb, JDAF, did I have it right?
JDAM,
okay. And you're getting satellite information. Are you getting a picture from the satellite?
No, the satellite information that'll inform that is strictly positional information.
Okay, so, but
the ability, what I see what you're getting at, we're just starting to do this sort of thing of being able to, and we're by no means there to where it all comes in this beautiful seamless network from anywhere, but we are pushing imagery, that is, you know, photographs, video, whatever, into individual aircraft cockpits. Where no matter what source that is coming from, we're able to put that. Now, is that true with every aircraft that we've got out there?
Yeah.
No. But do we want to get there? Yes. And we are working to get there to where any aircraft that's airborne, we will be able to take information from whatever source that we get it and put it into that. Now, the Navy's doing the same thing with ships. The Army's doing the same thing with tanks and armored personnel carriers.
Jeez. Now, a Predator... is fairly low flying, isn't it?
Yes.
And it takes a picture of the person they want to get?
Well, it has a variety of sensors on it, you know, video, infrared.
What I'm trying to get at is the distance between the Predator and ground is nothing like the difference between the ground and a satellite. Can a satellite give as good a picture as a Predator? You don't have to answer that precisely, but can the satellite give a very good picture so you can transfer that to a
Yes,
plane
satellites can give very good pictures. And then the level in between that I was just talking about, so you sort of have Predator, now you have Global Hawk, which is up, say, maybe at 60,000 feet, 60,000 feet, and then you have the satellite. All of these things have very good systems and can give you good imagery that you can act upon.
Well, so it seemed to me that maybe satellite war is a big story this time around. Do we have satellite war in 1991?
In a way, 1991 was the first space war because global positioning system, although it was not being used for smart bombs, was being used to get around. I, for example, as an air liaison officer to the French ground commander, was able to go into my Humvee, go with the French forces, go out into the Saudi Arabian and then the Iraqi desert with impunity.
We've come to an end. We can't answer that question. So I got to ask you a question. Have we had a digital revolution in the military? And if the answer has got to be yes, how much has that increased our capacity exponentially? Are we 10 times better, 8 times better, 9 times better than we were in 1991?
Yes, we've had a digital revolution. And I'd say at this point, if I had to quantify it, I'd say we're at least 5 times
better.
5
times. Thank you very much for stopping by. And thank you for stopping by. Stop by next week and learn more about the digital revolution. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.